Thank you to our young people for reenacting that first Palm Sunday where people took palm branches and their garments and laid them in the path as the Savior came into town. What a beautiful day we celebrate today on Palm Sunday, this Sunday leading up to Easter Sunday. Hope that you can join us next week for a very special day of worship, but let it not be just one day. Throughout this week, contemplate just what Easter means. We focus so much on Christmas, and we call it Christmas because it's a focus on who He is. But Easter is no less celebration because had that baby come, even in that miraculous way by virgin birth, and decided not to go to the cross, then we would be lost and undone without any hope of redemption. And yet, on that Sunday, as He entered Jerusalem, He entered as one they were screaming to, Hosanna, just as our kids sort of reluctantly began to say today. And it means, please save us. And that He certainly did. And we celebrate that today and every day, especially as believers this side of the cross. Stand as we continue to worship today. In your bulletin, you will see our call to worship down at the cross. Stand and sing if you are able. And if not, just have a seat and let it rip for the Lord this morning. Neighbors this morning with a big old smile and a hug.
Game youth trip will be Friday, April 14th. Meet at 5:45. The cost is $10. There will also be no free for all that night. Cambridge Hills Assisted Living Devotion next Saturday, April 15th at 10 a.m. All welcome to come and join in with the residents. For more info, see Virgie Weston. Awesome. We need candy and more candy for the kids' Easter celebration next Saturday, April 15th. If you can donate any, please bring by church by Saturday at 10:30 a.m. There is an Easter breakfast sign-up sheet in the parlor if you can help donate items for our annual Easter breakfast. Easter celebrations, Saturday, April 15th at 10:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. Kids Easter Celebration in Fellowship Hall. Sunday, April 16th, sunrise service at 6:30, breakfast at 9, joint Sunday school at 10. Easter Katana. the day he wore my crown at 11. The family of Emmer D. Long acknowledges with deep appreciation your kind expression of sympathy. It's through people like you that Jesus shows his love for us. You are God's greatest blessings. Thanks to all you for all you have done, and thanking God for you.
Thank you, Alex. As you can tell, our youth choir and youth are helping out today. It is Youth Sunday, and we are so grateful for you guys. And I'm just going to ask you to do it. Give them a hand for being willing to help us. Such a good-looking bunch of young people. I've got a couple other things real quick. First of all, there are some folks who are having a very special day in here today. In fact, quite a few. One of them I know is here. The other ones I haven't seen yet, so they may be in overflow or somewhere else. But Ralph Watson, please stand up so that we can adequately embarrass you. Ralph told me, I said, Ralph, either tell me how old you are or I'm going to make something up. He said 68. I guess he's being honest, but happy birthday, Ralph. Happy birthday to Lisa Harris, Mitzi Owen, and Kayla Perkins. I'm not sure if they're with us, but wish them a happy birthday if you are at all able to, because today is their birthday. Also, there is a very special outreach taking place at Lehigh Trailer Park this Saturday. This is an opportunity for you to come out. They'll be meeting, I believe, at Roxborough Baptist at 9 a.m. If not, I will try to get those details changed for you. But what we need is folks that will show up there at Roxborough Baptist that morning, willing to go out and catch this. All you have to do is hand them a bag that has several different churches' information in it, just inviting them to church, and you're going to hand them a cake. Now, how cool is that? We have yet to have anybody turn down a cake. In fact, they are willing to take two or three if you'll give it to them. But we need the cakes, too. So, that being said, if you are able and willing to either purchase or, better yet, make a cake or a pie, wrap it up, bring it, and put it in the kitchen before Saturday morning. We will have some folks on that team come by and check for cakes. And if you will just stick a little post-it on it for outreach, and that'll go out next week. This has proven to be a very special thing as we go into some of the tougher neighborhoods of our community and love on them in the name of Christ with a cake and a simple invitation to come and be with us at church and worship with us. There will also be a message and a free lunch offered to these folks that you'll be telling them about there, but it's a very easy way to reach out to folks. Also, as we approach Easter, I wanted to ask a favor of our members and anybody who's sitting in here that's willing. You know that one of the biggest things that happens here is that parking becomes an issue very quickly. First of all, if you're able to, as a family, drive one instead of 10 vehicles next week, because sometimes we have four in a family and six vehicles here somehow. I don't know how we manage that. Novel idea, let's carpool if we can on Easter, because next week there will be people who aren't in church typically who just feel that nudge, that prodding to be in church. And we want them to have somewhere to park. Nothing breaks this pastor's heart more than knowing that people ride through the parking lot and keep going because they have nowhere to park. So I'm going to ask you guys to be sacrificial next week and to park in the lot, the field, to the other side of the graveyard over here, as long as it's not muddy. We've been given permission to do that, but just make sure you respect that. But just park on that side, park sensibly over there, and leave these spaces over here if at all possible for those who might be visiting next week and alleviate those parking constraints next week. And next week, I'm going to beg of you, scoot up next to each other. Act like your family and like each other. I know it's a little less comfortable, but God forbid somebody miss the message of a beautiful cantata that the choir has worked so hard on and miss the message of Easter. So please be willing to do that for us next week and welcome those folks that come in. And speaking of being like expanding and having lots of folks in lots of places, Casey, would you mind holding the door open? Y'all know we have another congregation entirely next door in the fellowship hall. Do y'all still love them? Yeah. Most of them? Okay. So on three, you know what to do. I'm not even going to tell you. And let's see if they love us too on three. One, two, three.
We love you.
They still love us too, at least most of us. So, all right, one other quick announcement. You know we have a Vermont mission team that goes out each year. They're going to be flying up to Vermont this year. It's just as reasonable to do so and gives them a lot more time on the ground for this mission. But they're going to need a van driver on June the 17th. So what I need is a member of the church, 21 or older, willing to get up at the crack o' dawn and take a group to Raleigh-Durham Airport, and then they'll need a ride back on the 23rd. If you can do this for this team, either see myself or Vicky or Calvin Warren, and they would appreciate that very much. We will get it done one way or another, Vicky, even if I have to ride a bike to get you there. But let's hope we can find a volunteer. Just everybody go at one time. Y'all got to be there the same day. Talk. Maybe you got a ride right there. We'll figure it out. All right. But anyway, y'all pray for these mission teams. Honduras mission, Philippines mission is coming up. The Alaska mission is coming up, and the Vermont mission is coming up. They're all just sort of crowding in on us. Start praying for these folks that are going on these mission trips to reach out to people. All right, well, that's enough announcements for one day. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask His blessings on all of this and that which is to come. Father God, thank You for a beautiful day. Such a pretty spring day that we're able to come and enjoy fellowship with other believers. To be with our family. And not just any family, but our eternal family. Those that You made family and blood kin through the blood that You shed on the cross. Thank You today that we celebrate that Palm Sunday when You began to initiate that plan of redemption. As You came into town, the people were yelling to You, please save us. And God, on this side of the cross, we are yelling, thank You for saving us. God, You could have taken that donkey and gone a whole different direction and said, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to die for them. Let them fend for themselves, and we'd have been hopeless. But You went. And so thank You for hearing the pleas and the cries of those people to save us. May we continue to take that truth out into this world, not just the week of Easter, but always. And Father, I do pray even now that even as we're packed Sunday after Sunday, that somehow we'll figure out a way to squeeze up, to tighten up, to make room for those who will visit us next week, and that they would absolutely catch on fire with us here next week in serving You. Father, we realize how sinful, how knuckleheaded we are, but we sure do love You. And we love this church. And we want to serve it and serve You the very best we can. So today we thank You for all of the events that are geared to that purpose, all of these announcements. And we just pray that You'd be at the center of all of it and that You'd bless it all. May many come to know Christ because of what's happening here, God. Help us to remember our mission is to grow the Christian family right here at home and all over the globe. Bless these missions that have been mentioned and be with all of them as they prepare to leave the comforts of home and go to foreign areas to share the love of Christ in tangible ways. Keep them safe, bring them back to us, but in the meantime, God, do a mighty work through them, for we know all You require of us is just that we be yielded and obedient. Bless their yieldedness, bless their obedience. And Father, now as we step away from a time of announcements and preliminaries, may our worship be sweet and pure. May we be here for the ultimate goal of pleasing You and putting a smile on Your face today. And we pray all of this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. All right. I think most of our young people went out, but if there are anybody left between the ages of 3 and 3rd grade, you can head out to Children's Church now and join the rest of those palm-waving crazies and enjoy yourself. It's time for the offertory hymn. And Alex is going to lead us, but offertory hymn is...
We're singing.
Oh, sorry, they're singing.
Yep. So you...
All right, because...
Y'all can stand and join in the offertory hymn. Because He Lives is either in your bulletin and the lyrics will be on the screen.
I believe in the sun.
Joseph is going to lead us in prayer.
Dear Lord, thanks for this day. Thanks for this offering. Thanks for these people. Please bless them as they give the offering. And amen.
Clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down, and every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. The gates make way before the King of Kings. Our God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power, fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before. Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before you. Our God is the Lamb. The Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains,
Thank you, youth. What a special song, Chainbreaker. We're talking about that today, ironically. Always works out that way. And a message entitled, Kalah and the Lost Sandal. Now, I asked this in one of my Sunday school classes this morning. I said, how many of you have a clue what that's talking about? And they were honest. They said, So how many of you know what I'm talking about? Kalah and the Lost Sandal. Sounds like a great title to a fairy tale, doesn't it? Not a fairy tale at all. It's a true story found in the book of Ruth. You know, it's funny how we do this. You know that I preach expositionally. In other words, I get into a book of the Bible and I just keep going. The only time I deviate from that is on special occasions when sometimes at holidays or different occasions I will preach a message that is a topical message. Well, it just so happens that we're having another one of those God-cidences that I don't need to go anywhere else. We can stay right where we are and continue into what's happening with Easter in this message, Kalah and the Lost Sandal. Now, I happen to be one of those guys that know a little bit about lost sandals. About 4 years ago, I had a young man call me up. He said, listen, can you meet me over here at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill? And I'm just looking for a reason to do that anyway. I know, half of you boo, half of you yay, whatever. He was like, can you meet me over here at Southern Rail? And I'm like, absolutely, because if you know me, you know I'm a Tar Heel, and you know I love trains. Well, Southern Rail is a restaurant in a train at Carolina. So I'm like, heck yeah, I'm there. So we go, and he said, I want to talk to you about asking Christ into my heart. And we do that in a restaurant that day. And this young man did come to Christ. He was getting ready to marry one of our young people who had left the church and had gone on in life to move away and was doing well. But she had shared Christ with him, and she said, if this is to go any further, you got to get this right. And so he accepted Christ that day, and he said, I want to be baptized. And I said, hallelujah, that's the next step. Show the world that you're proud of who you are, and show them that you've been washed clean of those sins. He said, but, and I'm like, uh-oh. He said, but I don't want a traditional baptism. He said, well, maybe I do. I said, well, what do you mean? He said, well, I don't want to do it in a pool in a church. I'm like, fine with me, as long as I don't care if it's a mud hole, whatever. Well, that's what he wanted. He wanted to be baptized in a mud hole. The one right out here that we call Roger's Pond. It's beautiful. One of the most beautiful ponds around, and you have to admit. And next week at 6:30, be here. We're going to get on our trailers. We're going to head out to the other side of that beautiful pond. I'd asked Miss Jenny Lou permission just last week, and she said, oh, whatever. So we're going out there next week, but what a beautiful pond it is. But it's a cow pond, or at least it was. Now, I'm not going to go into any gory detail, but that makes it a pretty thick mud hole at the bottom. So anyway, this young man says, I want to be baptized right out there. I've seen pictures, and that's where I want to go. I said, you got it, buddy. I mean, if somebody wants to be baptized, I'm going to do it. I don't care where they want to do it. So we planned this up one Sunday afternoon, and we go out there. It was a spring afternoon. The water was still cold. It was really cold, but no big deal. You know, it's just cold water. So I step in wearing my sandals. I take two steps, and then I pull my leg up, and the suction in that mud just said, so I performed, finished, and walked out of that pond without a sandal. And so far as I know, unless a cow ate it after the fact, I am so sorry, Jenny Lynn, there's still a sandal in your pond. But that being said, I have a little experience with a lost sandal. And you're thinking, where in the world is he going with this? I promise you, it's right here in the text. So as we jump into Ruth chapter 3:18, and then go into chapter 4, We're going to pick up in the narrative that we've already been reading. This book, written somewhere around 1000 B.C., an incredible love story, sort of stationed right there at the time of the judges when Israel kept going through these throes of doing the right thing, being blessed by God. Then they fall away from God, and of course God disciplines them. And there was just this endless cycle that was going on, and God kept trying His best by sending these particular judges and leaders to them to get them back on track. But they're right in that same cycle. You ever feel like you're in that cycle? You're walking with the Lord, things are going well, and then all of a sudden something happens and you feel confident and prideful. You begin to do it your way, and what happens? Everything goes to heck in a handbasket, doesn't it? Because our way just doesn't work. So don't be too hard on the children of Israel, because we do it too. But in the reality of what we're reading here, that's the backdrop. And there's this beautiful love story of a lady who says, you know what, I'm going to do it God's way. And in the end, she shows that that way works. Because we're going to see that this leads right to the lineage of our Savior, Jesus Christ, because of one woman's willingness to do the right thing. Just to bring everybody up to speed, not to review the whole book, but what's happening is a man and his two sons and his wife, they move out into a place that is a very wicked place. It represents the world. It's called Moab. It was a very wicked place with false gods that required human sacrifice. And I'm just going to tell you, I'm glad that we serve the God who sacrificed Himself and does not require us to be sacrificed on an altar physically and shed blood for our salvation. He did that for us. But they go into the world. They're trying to find food because there's a famine. God is disciplined in the area of Bethlehem. So they leave. And let me just tell you this again. If you don't hear anything else in Ruth, hear this. Do not leave where God is to be a part of the world thinking that the grass is greener on that side, because it never is. It's a dead end. So if you have walked away from the Lord, walk back. Now He's right there waiting on you, but it's a dead end if you're going any other direction. And they find that to be true. These two men, they marry daughters over there in Moab, which again was against the rules. They weren't supposed to marry and be unequally yoked with those who weren't believers, but they did it anyway. And so happens that all the men die. Elimelech the father, Mahlon and Chilion the sons, they all die. So you got three ladies left, widowed, and they don't know what to do, because in that culture, without a fellow to come along and help you, that culture pretty much wrote you off. And you needed redeeming, which means you needed to be bought back and helped, and they had no help. So this lady, Naomi, the mother-in-law, she says, I'm going to go back to where I came from. It's never too late to go back to God, folks. Don't ever miss that point in Ruth. It's never too late. If you've strayed from God, turn around. He's right behind you with His arms wide open, saying, welcome home, my child. She says, I'm going to go home. And one of the daughter-in-laws stay. They stay there in the world. And Naomi could have done a much better job, I think, persuading her and getting her to come along with her back to where God was. Nonetheless, one stays. Orpah stays right there in Moab. And Ruth says, not me. I have come to believe in this God that you believe in. He's the real deal. I know it. I can tell it. And so wherever you go, I'm going. Wherever you live, I'm going to live. Your people are going to be my people. Your God is going to be my God. And wherever you die, that's where they're going to put me 6 feet under too. She's showing loyalty, and may we do the same in our relationships, especially towards God. But they come back to Bethlehem. As they come back into town, people are excited to see them. I'm sure they want to know the story, but they know a little bit of it, and so they're just welcoming back in. But nonetheless, after they left, their land ended up in sort of a mortgage situation. They don't have anywhere to go. They don't have any food. They don't have any way to provide for themselves. And so they begin to say, what in the world do we do to get by? We got to eat. We got to live. We got to survive. And so it says that Ruth was willing to work. I'll tell you, when things get tough, there's a lot of people that got their hands out doing this, but there are very few of them that are willing to work to earn their keep. Just want somebody to hand them something. You know, that's not the way we were created. You don't work, you don't eat. That's not my word, it's the Bible. Ruth understood it, and she says, I'm willing to do my part. And so she goes out into the field where they are commanded to leave a little extra in the corners of the field so that those who were poor, if they're willing to work, they can come get it. Ruth goes out there and shows her willingness to work to earn her keep. And it just so happens, and I told you, there are no just so happens. No such thing as coincidence. There's God's dance. It says she just so happened to end up in the field of Boaz. This was somebody that was related to her husband who has passed away. And in that day and time, if you read Deuteronomy and Leviticus, you see that when a person had died, that a brother or a kinsman or the nearest of kin were supposed to marry them and redeem them and take care of them so that their land would stay in the family of Israel and so that the name would be protected. And so she realizes, okay, I just happened to be in the field of one of my kinfolks, so this is a great thing. And let me tell you, God worked that out. There are no accidents. God is working every day. We just don't see it. But she's there and she begins to work, and Boaz looks out and he likes what he sees and he likes what he's heard about her, a woman of virtue. He said, I've heard how loyal you are to your mother-in-law, how you came back from Moab. You're willing to work, so don't go anywhere else. I want you to stay right here. And then he starts to tell his people, he said, not only do I want y'all to let her work, but I want you to drop some extra. Well, isn't that how God works? If we will just be obedient, God will provide for us an extra on top of what we need. Boy, if you don't realize that, you don't know my God. Because I'll tell you, he doesn't just give us what we need. He gives us much, much more. We sit here today an affluent people. You don't believe it? Get on a plane and go with one of these groups to one of these missions. Go see the things that we've seen overseas. Watch one of these documentaries on television. It's real. There are people over there that literally don't eat every day of the week. I experienced that myself. Had a guy look at me one day and he said, oh, we don't have enough to eat 7 days, so we don't eat on the Lord's day. How many of y'all didn't eat this morning? And if you didn't, was it by choice or because you didn't have? I'll guarantee you, you have. And you've got beautiful clothes. And you've got so much more than you need. And that's what's happening here. He's saying, don't go anywhere else. I'm going to take care of you. And I'm going to give you a little extra. And he does that. And so then the matchmaker, the mother-in-law we talked about last week, she goes to work. How many of you young people have tried to put people together? You're like, hey, you'd go well with such and such. And yeah, I got one honest guy. He's been raising his hand all day, worshiping the Lord. Now he's being honest. You know you've done it, and you know you've done it. You all got that friend that's single, and you take it upon yourself to fix that. You ever thought maybe they like it that way? And I told you last week, look, you do what you want. I'm not getting into the matchmaking business because either you end up a hero or a zero. Because you match them up with the wrong one, you got trouble, and they're going to remember who did it, too. And the next time you come trying to matchmake, they're going to be like, oh, no. Don't, just stop right there. I don't even want to meet your friend. Oh, and you know, and you know when you matchmake people, you know how it goes. Well, they got a great personality. Y'all know what that means. They ugly. I'm just saying what you know. But the truth is, some matchmaking is a good idea because as much as I told you, you shouldn't be matchmaking people. Let the Lord bring people together because guess what? That works. God's the matchmaker when it comes to that. But there is a matchmaking process that we're supposed to be a part of every day. And I hope you guys are doing it. Y'all have incredible energy and ability to do this. And so do the rest of us because we should be matching people up with the one who loves their soul. We should be so much more concerned about our single friends, our married friends, our foreign friends, all our friends, about getting them together with Jesus Christ than we are about putting somebody else in their life. Now, look, we were created for relationships. I get that. That's important. But let God put those things together. I mean, you can make sure they're in the same room, but just don't push it. But when it comes to Jesus, we ought to be matching people up with him every single day because you know he'll never let them down. You know he's always going to be what they need. And so Naomi looks and she was like, oh, you just happened to end up in Boaz's field. And I can just see the mother-in-law wheels turning. She's thinking, I see something here. And she was right. She saw an opportunity to take advantage of that Levirate marriage law that we read of in the book of Leviticus and Deuteronomy. She said, you know, he's related to us and he's a man of means. He's stable. He's a good man, and it sounds like he is attracted to you. I mean, he's made an effort to make a big deal. I mean, she had come home with a 30-pound doggy bag of barley. I mean, this man made sure she had plenty, and Naomi's thinking, why not? And so she tells her, get gussied up, get cleaned up, go take a bath, anoint yourself with some perfume, and let's go do something. And I told you last week, it sounded weird. And guys, don't be expecting this. Don't expect to wake up in the middle of the night and some beautiful woman laying at your feet. But that's what happened. It was a Far Eastern custom. that if you wanted somebody to know, see, he was a generation older than Ruth. And she knew that he wouldn't propose to her out of respect. And so it was perfectly acceptable for her to get all gussied up, get cleaned up, anoint herself with oil, and lay at Boaz's feet. And when he woke up, he's like, whoa, there's a woman at my feet. I mean, I can just see that. One day I just want to talk to this guy. I can't wait to meet Boaz. But he wakes up and he's like, wow, there's a woman at my feet. Oh, and it's Ruth. He already had his eye on Ruth. I am convinced of that if you read the scripture. But as he sees her, he knows what's going on. And he says, I'll tell you what. I would love to make you mine. I would love to redeem you. But I want to do this right. And so all night she lays at his feet, no hanky-panky, nothing going on. Don't let anybody ever exposit the scripture incorrectly in Ruth. Nothing happened. He made sure of it. And he said, I want you to get up and leave before anybody sees you because I don't want any talk. Can you believe that people gossiped way back then like they do now? And let me just tell you right now, this is a good time for me to slide it in. If you are a gossip, shut your mouth. And I'll just move on because it is a sin and you're not supposed to be talking about something if you ain't part of the problem or the solution. Leave it between those folks and God and pray for them. I digress. But he said, get up and leave before anybody sees you. And he says, I'm going to take care of it. I'm going to tell you something, folks. If you missed that last week, I've been telling you the whole book of Ruth that Boaz is a picture of Christ. And I'm going to tell you this. He has looked at you and he says, don't worry about it. I got you. Have you read Matthew 5 and 6? He says, I'm going to take care of your needs. I'm going to take care of you. And I could take you to a million other scripture that tells you not to worry. God's got it. Oh, but we worry so often about so much. Things that don't matter. Things we have no control over. And we consume ourselves with worry. You do not serve the God of the universe and worry like that. Don't do it. It's an embarrassment. It's a slap in the face of the Almighty when you say, you can't handle my problems. It's too big. We need to quit that. Boaz looked at her in no uncertain terms in this chapter 3, and he says, I got you. I'm going to do it right because there's somebody else that's in line that's a closer kin who has to be given the right to marry you. But if he won't, I got you taken care of. So either way, it's going to be all right. So I'm going to tell you this, Christians. If you belong to the Lord, either way, it's going to be all right. Now, you have a human responsibility in this. God's will is not going to be thwarted, but I can tell you, you can either earn blessings or disciplines in this process by how you respond to Matthew 6:33. And it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. All these things is a loose translation saying, I got it. I'm going to take care of everything. Just please be obedient. Please walk with me because you cannot expect God to bless you when you are doing things that He cannot bless. You don't support things, people, or anything else that you don't support. Don't expect God to. But if you jump in line with the Lord and get what Matthew 6:33 is saying and seek His will first, I'm telling you, He's got you. And even if not, He's got you because His will is going to be carried out. But moving right along, he says, I've got it. And she gets back home and says to Naomi, this is what he said. And in chapter 3, verse 18, after that lengthy introduction, Naomi looks at Ruth and she said, sit still, my daughter, until thou know how the matter will fall. For the man will not be in rest until he have finished the thing this day. What a beautiful, beautiful passage. Now, we're going to jump into chapter 4 in a minute, but let's just look at verse 18 as we finish up chapter 3. Naomi looks at her, and in the words of Psalm 46:10, she says, be still and know that He is God. Yep. It's the same word. If you go to Psalm 46:10, it says, be still and know that I'm God. The word is Rafi. Rafi. And it means be at peace. Calm down, relax, and wait. Amen. You know what? We are so impatient, and I am the guy that has no right to say anything about patience. I'm just going to tell you, I want it done yesterday. I mean, I just figure, hey, look, if it needs doing, let's do it yesterday, right? Patience is not something I'm good with. None of us are, but we have got to be patient with God. Miss tells me this all the time. In fact, Betty Stansel, who's celebrating her 80th birthday this weekend, she had it painted on a plaque for me, and it says, God may not be early, but He's never late. So she's saying, if He's told you He's going to take care of it, He is. Folks, if God told you he's going to take care of it, he is. And guess what? He told you, I'm going to take care of it. Amen. You're my kid. I'm going to look after you. And we know that all things from Romans 8 work together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. He said, I got it. She said, just relax. Sit down and just wait a little bit. And that's the hardest thing to do, isn't it? Just wait a little bit, because he's not going to rest until he takes care of it. And that word there for finished, it says he's not going to be at rest until he has finished it, is the word Kalah. That's why the message is entitled Kalah and the Lost Sandal. We'll get to the sandal in a minute, but it's the same word that is transliterated into Greek as telestai. You ever heard that one? It's exactly what Jesus said on the cross. It's one of the last things he said. Telestai. He yelled it out with his dying breath. And it meant it is finished. It's the same word here, just transliterated into Hebrew. He says he will not rest until it is finished and all is taken care of, so just relax. Folks, if you miss the rest of the message, hear me. God is at work in your life. He is in work in the worst of situations. And he has a plan that we may not understand and that oftentimes we will not like. But he is God. He is the chain breaker, the way maker. He's the one that can take care of all of our needs, and he's on the job doing just that. And in the end, it's all going to work out to his glory and our good if we are his kids. And he's not going to rest until it is finished. And I think about Easter as I read that passage. This is a perfect passage leading up to Easter, because Jesus did not rest. Palm Sunday, he comes marching in. He's a hero. Everybody's like, come save us. Please save us. And they're celebrating him. And then all of a sudden, things start to look different, and they turn and run. He could have turned and run too. But he did not rest until it was finished, until Kalah had taken place. Moving forward, then went Boaz to the gate and set him down there. And behold, the kinsman of whom Boaz had spoken came by, and to whom he said, ho, such a one, turn aside, sit down here. He turned aside and he sat down. And so he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, sit you down here. And they sat down. And he said unto the kinsman, Naomi, that is come again out of the country of Moab, selleth a parcel of land which was our brother Elimelech's. And I thought to advertise to thee, saying, buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people. If thou wilt redeem it, redeem it. But if thou wilt not redeem it, then tell me, that I may know. For there is none to redeem it beside thee, and I'm after thee. And he said, I will redeem it. Then said Boaz, what day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must also buy of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance. And the kinsman said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar mine own inheritance. Redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it. Now this was the manner in former time in Israel concerning the redeeming and concerning changing. For to confirm all things, a man plucked off his shoe and gave it to his neighbor. And this was a testimony in Israel. Therefore the kinsman said unto Boaz, buy it for thee. So he drew off his shoe. And Boaz said unto the elders and unto all the people, you are witnesses this day that I have bought all that was Elimelech's, and all that was Chilion's and Mahlon's, and of the hand of Naomi. Moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of Mahlon, have I purchased to be my wife, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among his brethren and from the gate of this place. Ye are all witnesses this day. Let us pray. Father, thank you. Thank you that we can come together and jump into your word. Thank you for that lengthy introduction that brings us all up to the same page. But God, what a story it is of redemption, of love. And in this story, we see Boaz as a picture of your son, Christ, who came and would not rest until he redeemed us. Thank you, God, that we sit here today, a people redeemed, bought back with the price of the King of the universe's blood. Help us to see in this beautiful story today that it is finished. And we need no more to worry or to fret. But God, help us to also see the beauty in how Boaz went about this, as well as your son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A lot of fancy words here, but it's real simple. Boaz wants to do things right, so he goes before the water gate. Not the water gate you're thinking of. Nixon wasn't there. But he goes before the water gate there in Jerusalem, which was a place where business took place. It's a place where important things went down. And he goes and he grabs for him just a witness or two, right? No, he grabs 10 of the elders and 3 witnesses, and they plop down at the gate. He said, sit down. I've got some business that we need to attend to. Now, I love the way he did this. He made sure that there was crowd enough to be witness to this. And you know how many he needed to make this happen? 2. All he needed was 2. But he had way more witnesses here to make sure that this thing was done right. I like this guy's style. Always go above and beyond when it comes to doing right. Always. Because in this culture, I can tell you, it's necessary. And it was in theirs too, and he knew it. And it just so happens, another one of those coincidences, that the guy who was next in line to marry Ruth just happens to walk by. We know better, don't we? God put that fellow right there at that time. And he says, ho, come here. And if you really get back into the Hebrew and translate it, he's like, hey, so-and-so, come over here. That's what he said. It's almost like he's from Jersey or something. Hey, so-and-so, get over here. So he comes over and he sits down right there at the gate, and he tells him, he says, listen, Naomi's come back, and you know that her land is in that mortgage situation. She's not able to buy it back. So she's going to lose that, and we don't know who it's going to end up with. And I'm willing to buy it back, but you're next in line. And he's saying, are you going to buy it back? And he's doing this in front of all these witnesses. He says, listen, are you going to buy it or not? And the guy says, heck yeah, I'll buy it. And then he says, oh, but by the way, if you get that piece of land now, Ruth comes with it. Because Naomi brought a daughter-in-law back from Moab. He's like, oh, hold up. I don't know why he didn't want Ruth. Apparently she was attractive. I mean, this guy, Boaz, thought so. And she was young enough. But he was worried when he heard that. He's like, nah, I don't want that. You know, I don't know if it was prejudice because she was a Moabitess, which is dead wrong, but whatever. Because she'd come to God at this point. Or if it was just that it was going to do something that he didn't like, or he had his eye on another lady, which I highly suspect. But he said, look, I cannot buy it for myself, because if I do, I'll mess up my own inheritance. So he probably had his eye on somebody else who probably had a little land coming with the package. I don't know. Doesn't matter. He just said, I can't do it. So you go ahead. And he gives Boaz the right to redeem. I want you to know in this picture that this guy, whoever he was, old so-and-so, represents the law. He represents the law. What am I talking about? In the Old Testament, you'll find that there were 613 laws that these people were supposed to keep to be right before God. Can you imagine that? We struggle with 10. I mean, if you guys would just grab a hold of 10 and hang on to them, if we would just do the 10 commandments, we'd turn the world upside down. 613 laws. Say, why in the world were there so many laws? The law was in place to try to keep people in line, but it was also there to show us that there was no way on earth we could be good enough by keeping the law. The law was inadequate. There's no way we could have done that. And if it were to be required of us to keep 613 laws to enter into glory, we'd all be headed to hell in a big old handbasket. It's just a fact. Couldn't do it. I'll guarantee you before this day is over, you will have broken about a third of those 613 laws. It's just the way it was. It hearkens to me up to Romans 8:3. Listen to what Paul says in Romans 8:3. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Romans 8:3 says that the law could not save. Why? Because the law was dependent upon weak flesh to keep it. And nobody was strong enough to keep it all. This guy represents that. The fact that we could not be saved by the law. Ruth couldn't be redeemed by this fellow. We can't be redeemed by the law. And yet there was a redeemer that stepped in and said, I'll take care of that. And he did it for us too. For her it was Boaz. For us his name is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And so Boaz says, then I'm going to take care of it, and I want y'all all to be witnesses. And then he takes on this another Far Eastern tradition. We don't get it, because we would never do such a thing. But the dude yanks off a sandal, and he tosses his Birkenstock over to the other guy. He was like, now y'all be witnesses of it. Now, let me ask you this. If I were to take my shoe off right now, and you didn't pass out, and I threw it over there to Ralphie, and said, Ralph, we got a deal. I'm going to pay you $100 for that Bible case. Now, how many of y'all going to remember that? Every last one of you. Because I just threw a shoe at the brother. It was something that stood out. And it was their tradition. It was their custom. And so he took his shoe off and he gave it to him. And he said, now y'all check this out. I'm going to make it clear. So he reiterates his case. I'm going to redeem all that was Naomi's, including Ruth. Jesus Christ came. And he took off his sandals. And he walked up the Via Dolorosa, the way of the cross, having been beaten to within an inch of his life. He was spit on, cursed by the same people that yelled Hosanna as he came into town. But he kept walking. He went to the cross and he was nailed there on a tree that he had created. Because he would not rest until it had been finished. Kalah, Telestai, just like Boaz. And he did it in front of the world to show that I have redeemed not only my creation, but every individual in it who will accept what I have done. I hope you have accepted that today. You know, Boaz had gone to a lot of trouble and lost a good sandal. Bless his heart. There's a good sandal in that pond out there somewhere right now. I got a match to it, but it ain't much good. Man, he had just rendered a pair of shoes useless, and they didn't have what we had, folks. This was a big deal. He gave him a shoe. He's without a sandal. He's gone through all this trouble to redeem Ruth. But you know what Ruth could have done? She could have said, man, I ain't marrying you, old man. She had a choice. And today you have the ultimate choice. I hope you have already looked Jesus Christ in the eye and in the heart and said, you are mine and I'll be yours for eternity. Folks, sometimes we turn these things into just stories or fairy tales. This is the word of the living God. This is the book that tells us how he feels about us. And just as Boaz went to all this trouble to redeem Ruth, she could have denied it. You can deny him today. You see, Ruth, had she denied him, would have had no real hope. Anybody she would have married outside of this Levirate law would have further put her in jeopardy of breaking the laws of the land and being excommunicated. She could have gone without food, provision. And that's bad. The things that we go through on earth, it's tough, but this is just temporary. So if she'd have denied Boaz, it would have been a bad situation, but it wouldn't have been an eternal bad. But if you deny Christ today, who went through so much, all that trouble that made what Boaz went through look like nothing, if you deny him, it has eternal consequence. It doesn't mean that you're just going to have a bad life. It means that when it's over, and it will be over. Did my 65th funeral since last January on Friday. I'm telling you, I've seen it. Life ends. And it's going to end for all of us. And when that happens, if you have denied this Christ who has come to redeem you, you've lost it all. You've lost it all. He is telling her, I want to give you a good life. Jesus is telling you he wants to give you eternal life. And yet destruction awaits those who will not accept. Now we're going to find out next week, or a week after next, that Ruth accepts. We're going to find out that her life was so, so blessed. At the end of this story, we're going to find that this Naomi who begins the story as one with empty arms will be holding a precious child. She went from despair to beauty. You can do the same if you accept this Jesus who Boaz is a type of. So I want you to think about that. Kalah and the lost shoe. It is finished. It's all done. I remember when Micah was a little bitty fella. He would eat and he was a healthy eater. Still is. I'm telling you, y'all pray for me. I literally now have a preteen and a teen in my house, and so just keeping groceries is interesting. But when he was little, he'd sit there and eat. Before he was able to really speak much, he'd sit there and eat, and it would be stuffed in earlobes and all in his hair, that little redhead full of sticky food or whatever, and he'd have it all over his clothes and everything else like kids do. But a whole lot of it would make it in that pie hole. And when he was done, he'd say, all done. All done. God has said that to us. It's all been done. Religion has us running around like chickens with our head cut off, seeing what we can do, when what really matters is what's been already done. He didn't rest until he took care of business. And that was for you. Be sure that you sit still and watch him work in your life and accept what he's done. And every time you see a sandal, give it a thought. Every time you see these silly shoes hanging on power lines, give it a thought. I don't know what that's all about. They say it's gang related, but I just turned it into a Jesus thing. You see a shoe hanging on something, think about it. Boy, Jesus gave it all, not just a shoe, for me. Folks, as we approach Easter, don't let it be just another week. As we approach Good Friday and Easter Sunday, remember what it is. It's the sovereign of the universe giving his all for you. It's all done. Aren't you glad? Christians, praise him this morning as we sing our invitation song. Those who do not know him, man, blaze a trail down this aisle. Don't wait. Give him what he really wants, your heart, and watch what he'll do for you. On top of eternal life, he'll bless you in ways you could never imagine. Let us pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for again for this beautiful day in your house. For all these folks. For just for loving us. Lord, as we look at this love story of Boaz and Ruth, we see that he went to a lot of trouble to redeem this lady. He was in love. He wanted her badly, but he wanted to do it right. But that's nothing compared to what you did. God, you loved us so much that you stretched out your arms and you died. The Bible tells us that greater love hath no man than to lay down his life for a friend. You have called us friend, and you lay down your life, and you've made us family. Thank you for what we celebrate at Easter. And God, if we've already accepted that, help us to rejoice in it, but be the matchmakers that are trying to get everybody else to this truth as well. Help us to get there to them and say, look, it ain't about what we can do. It's about what's been done. It's all done. So that they too can have peace with the Lord. Father, I ask you this day, help us to truly do business with you today on this altar or where we stand, so that when we leave, we're all right before you. And thank you for the beautiful story of Boaz that shows us in a different way just what you meant to us. Bless this invitation. Have your will in our hearts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Page 187 in the garden. Please stand as we sing if you're able. And maybe the Lord's working with you on other things today, but whatever it is, the altar's open. We're here to pray with you. We're here to help you through that. Thank you. Time, but have a seat because we got important business to attend to. Today, to my left, and come on over a little closer. Come a little closer. This is Reverend. Look at these hands going. They just want to say hi. Look at this. This is crazy. To my left is Reverend Arnold Price and his wife, his precious wife, Jan. You've already heard him sing. You're going to hear my brother as narrator for our cantata next week, and she'll be singing in the choir. They're already plugging in here, and they love it here. They've been in ministry for 47 years. 47 years. And I guess officially they've retired, but you know how that goes with preachers. They don't retire, they just preach other places. So they've come here some time ago saying, we know that God directed us this way. And we talked this week about that, and they want to be members, official here at Antioch. And so all these hands up, there's no way I'm going to get them all, so y'all just know that I can't. But I do present these two to you as wonderful servants of the Lord, Jan and Arnold Price, for membership here at our church. And I will say I saw Gail Glagowski's hand go up first, but I got to give a second to a son, Ivan. Ivan gets the second. So now the circle is complete with the Price family. They're all here with us, I think. No, are there other kids? Other kids, I should have known that. They live in Raleigh. Should have known that. They're a preacher. One kid's not enough, right? But no. But we got most of the family, and we welcome you with open arms. All in favor, amen this morning.
Amen.
All right, welcome home. Is there anything you guys would like to share?
Just glad to be home. Good to be with this church and love the people.
Amen. Amen. We're so happy to have you guys. I just don't have words for it. Before you head out, come give them the full hand of fellowship. Shake their hand, hug their neck, and help them to continue to plug in. I don't think they've had any trouble with that. They're just jumping in, but just help them continue to do that. If you're on a committee or something that's up to some good things, grab them and say, hey, come check this out, so they can find even more places to serve. But God bless you guys for joining us, and just happy to be a part of this imperfect family with you. All right, well, all of that behind us, we're going to close in prayer. Rick Legrone, I'd like for you to do that this morning. As you leave this week, contemplate those things you've heard. Yeah, we've been reading a love story, but there is one that is far greater, and that is the love of Christ for his children. Make sure that you're loving him back, that you're living for him daily, and I promise you life is so much sweeter when you accept the lover of your soul. And if there is one here that just yet to do that, it doesn't have to happen on an altar on a Sunday morning. If you want to know the Lord, you come grab one of us, and we'd be glad to show you what it takes. It's real simple. But just consider that decision. And as we head to Easter, remember those couple of housekeeping things. If you're willing to park over in that lot on the other side of the Rock Graveyard, that'd be very appreciated. So please don't block that entrance over there. And get over there and park and just be a little sacrificial and scoot up next to the people in the pews with you next week. Because here's the thing. If you don't scoot up, I'm just going to get on the mic and say, hey, can y'all scoot up? Might as well go ahead and do it and just go to the outside of the aisle so that as people come in, they can just jump right in the seats. And you know what? I'll dare you to do this. When we run out of seats, as I likely think we will, just plop down on the floor, or you can have my chair. I don't need it. So that being said, let us close in prayer. God bless you all.
Welcome. Father, we thank you for today. We're humbled by your presence here today. Help us walk. May your light shine before us as we go through this week. May God direct us. May everything we do and say be pleasing to you. Through Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.